Yeah.
You do? Thanks. It doesn't give me the option while screen sharing. Okay. Yeah, please, Federica, go ahead.
Thank you, Charlie. Hi everyone, I'm Federica and I'm the chair of ISB 2022 virtual conference, and today is our last session. So we are going to have quite a busy schedule because we will start with the annual general meeting from our chair, that is Nicole Vasilevsky, and she's here today. And then we are going to have the talks of the recipients of the Biocuration Career Awards, that are Shirin and Antonia. Charlie, please, can we show the next slide? Thank you so much. And then we are going to have a short coffee break and we are going to move to Gerardtown for our virtual poster session and the social hour. And also today, Charlie, please, next slide. Thank you. As you know, we already had two sessions, plus a workshop. The first two sessions that included two panel discussions about promotion, dissemination of biocuration efforts and sustainability and longevity of biocuration projects. And then some days ago, we had a careers in biocuration workshop that was led by Nicole. So you can find all this information on our website, and the previous sessions are already available in our YouTube channel. And Charlie, please, next slide. Yes, it's we want to thank you from our organizing committee. So the organizing committee was composed by me, Philippe Lemercier from Swiss Institute of Bioinformatics, Sushma Naitani, Oregon State University, Nicolas Miliaras, National Institutes of Health, Rama Balakrishnan from Genentech, and Charles Stapley Hoyt from Harvard Medical School. And please, Charlie. Okay, so the annual general meeting talk will be led by Nicole, as we said before. She is the chair of the International Society for Biocuration, so she will tell us more things about what we did as executive committee this year and what are the plans for the next year for the society. And next slide, please.
Oh, that's it. We don't have any more. Nicole can already go ahead.
Okay. So Nicole, you can start. Thank you, Charlie.
Here we go. Share screen. Okay. Everyone can see my screen?
No, nope, we're looking at the wrong thing. We're looking at speaker. Yeah.
Can you see that?
We're still looking at speaker notes.
Huh. Okay. Stop sharing. Of course, it worked when we were practicing. Now it's not. How's this? Can you see?
I don't see anything yet. You're not sharing
yet. Me either.
No, not before we saw something. Now we don't see anything.
Okay, let's try this. How's this?
We're still looking at speaker notes.
Jeez. Yeah. Okay. Okay. Can you see?
Perfect.
Okay. Okay, so I'm going to do the annual general meeting today for the Biocuration Society. I'm doing this on behalf of our, I'm the chair of the executive committee, and I'm presenting this on behalf of the ISB executive committee. So just a few logistics regarding the AGM and just the virtual conference in general. We want to make sure we abide by the code of conduct. So the code of conduct is available here at this link. And then we've already mentioned that the slides are being recorded. So we've had a really great committee over this last year. These are the members of the executive committee from 2021 to 2022. I've been the chair of the committee for this past year, and Ruth Levering is our secretary, who's done a really wonderful job of keeping us on track with all of our tasks and such. And Robin Ha is our treasurer, who's done an amazing amount of work managing our finances and getting things more modernized and on track. We've had wonderful contributions from our other members, Federica, Shishma, Marianne, Randy, Rama, and Parul. So this is the current committee. The elections are underway, and I believe they're closing down tomorrow, or is it maybe tonight? So we will be announcing the results of the new elected members of the committee later next week. So we have six candidates for the to join the committee. We have four open spots. Ruth Levering is up for re-election, so she. I hope that she'll be rejoining us for the committee next year. And Randy, unfortunately, will be stepping down, so we won't have her on the committee again next year. Her service term has, she's done one term and it's coming to an end, and we are very grateful to her and all the work that she's done. And those of you who attended the extraordinary general meeting or followed along with the emails noted that you may remember that we are increasing the number of members on the ISB to have 9 members instead of 7. This is so we could help distribute the workload amongst us and lighten some of the load amongst the individual EC members. So we'll have four spots that are open, and we'll see the election results next week. And thank you to all of these folks for running, and thank you for your interest. And we're very pleased to announce the winners of the Biocuration Awards. We have Shirin from SciBite, who won the Excellence in Early Career, the Excellence in Biocuration Early Career Award. And we have Antonia from the EBI, who won the Excellence in the Advanced Career Award. And like Federica said, they'll be giving a talk after this. They'll each be giving talks after this session. So as part of the annual general meeting, the tradition is that we share some highlights from the ISB over the past year. So these are some of our highlights from the 2021 to 2022 year. So just an overview of the ISB Executive Committee and the ISB in general. So the Executive Committee oversees the work of the society, and our goals are to promote the work of biocreators and the work that we do. So just to make our profession bring more awareness to our profession, bring more awareness to the utility of the work that we do, and try to create networking opportunities and connections between each other and other and researchers and those that we are targeting our efforts towards. We also want to promote communication between biocreators that are working in this field, whether you be a professional biocreator or someone that's just participating in biocreation as one of your roles in the job that you do. We want to provide venues for us to be able to communicate things like conferences that are coming up, or interesting things that we've worked on, or different tools that are becoming available. So we have a few different communication routes. We have like our mailing list, we have a Slack channel. We have these conferences and workshops where we can communicate with each other. And also one of the goals of the ISB is to encourage best practices. So we have a place where we have our website where we can document things like best practices and other aspects of the work that we're doing. So this is our financial report from the past year. So this is reporting on the finances from 2021. So currently we have 197 members in the ISB. This number has gone down a little bit because we typically see memberships increase around the time where we have in-person conferences, because at the in-person conferences, we offer a discount to members. So since we haven't had an in-person conference in the last 3 years due to COVID, we had to change the 2020 conference to virtual at the last minute. As you remember, last year was virtual and this year as well. Luckily, we'll be going back to in-person conferences next year. And as Charlene is in the chat, it's in-person in Italy in 2023. And we have more details about that in subsequent slides. We also were able to collect membership dues now via Stripe and PayPal. And we're working with Credit Suisse to help modernize some of our financial practices. We are able to get a credit card for the society, and Robin's done a really amazing job with trying to get our everything sorted out with our accounting practices. And this is just a report down of the right hand side. There's a report down of the fees that we collected over this last year. So we've collected the CHF is Swiss francs. That's the society is based in Switzerland. All of our accounting is done in Switzerland. So we collect our fees in francs, and the expenditures that we've had this year have included sponsorships, administrative fees, and we've been paying, we pay our obligatory taxes. So we're left with a balance in 2021, at the end of 2021, of about 115,000 francs. So if you have any questions regarding the finances and our expenditures within the ISB, please contact our treasurer, Robin, and he can share any more details with you. So some of the other opportunities that were offered by the ISB and some of the work that the executive committee is overseeing is two things that we are doing are one, offering awards, fellowships, and funding. So this includes our ISB awards, which you just heard about our award winners for the Biocuration awards from this year. We also offer travel fellowships to attend our conferences. So this year we offered fellowships for I think it was one or two attendees to attend the UK local conference, which was held in May. And we'll be offering travel fellowships for people who are interested in applying for the conference coming up next year in April. Anyone's welcome to apply, although we try to encourage people who are coming from junior faculty or people coming from lower income countries or have particular special needs for obtaining a travel fellowship. We offer microgrants, and these are still available. These have been available for long. I think they were created at least 10 plus years ago. And this is an opportunity for someone to apply for 500 Swiss francs the options are kind of open. A lot of times it's to have a gathering with other bio creators or to fund particular needs amongst the curators. So there's more information on our webpage about the microgrants, and we really encourage people to apply. We haven't had a lot of people applying in the last year or so. So we really encourage anyone to take a look at the microgrant opportunity and see if there's anything that your project could use that funding and send us application. We also offer exchange fellowships for anyone is invited to go attend another lab and learn some practices from that lab. So if you have, say you want to go learn how to do like goat annotations, you could go visit one of the groups that's doing this, and we will fund, I think it's up to 1500 francs for travel and accommodations and that kind of thing. So also encourage you to look at the webpage for more information about that and consider applying for these exchange fellowships. And also we offer a 20% discount on publications in the database journal. Database is the official journal of the ISB. And as far as communications and outreach, we have a quarterly newsletter that's put out four times a year. We have our email list, which has been very well used. And I think most people are probably on the email list. If you're not, if you look on our website, there's a link to how to join the mailing list. We have our Twitter channel that we post information about opportunities within ISB and related opportunities. We have training opportunities. We have a website dedicated to training resources. And we also post job postings on our website as well. So if you have a job opening, feel free to send it to us. Or if you're looking for a job, we encourage you to look there. We've created a lot of subcommittees within the ISB executive committee as well. And one of the subcommittees is the IT infrastructure group. So So they've done a lot of work to help keep our website up to date and take care of our IT kind of needs. Parul Gupta has been the membership officer this past year, and she's helped make sure that our members are notified when renewals are coming up. The memberships are for set for 1 year. So now we've updated it so the reminders are sent one week before the expiration, instead of before it was sending out about 3 months before. We've removed expired members' information after 3 years, and we've also been promoting the ISB distribution list. And we've done a lot of improvements to the webpage. Federica led this effort. And if you go to our website now, you can see a new updated template that we're using for the website. And as we talked about at the extraordinary general meeting, we revised our constitution, which is now called the Articles of Association. And we are now going to allow 9 members onto the ISB executive committee. And as well, due to the laws in Switzerland and the roles of becoming a nonprofit, we have to have a Swiss member on the board. So Federica led the outreach and training, and Federica and Randy led the outreach and training efforts in the group. So we have updated training materials. There's a webpage that's dedicated to training materials, which include training materials regarding biocuration best practices, and data and how to make annotations for databases. Also training materials on data management and FAIR standards, the findable, accessible, interoperable, and reusable. There's also links to ontology development training materials, which I've been heavily involved in, and also programming and bibliometric training materials. And there's been more efforts coming up in the future where we're gonna try to offer some monthly or regular training sessions and webinars online. So keep a lookout for that. And if you're interested in participating in that, we'll love to hear your feedback or have you participate. We also worked on a lot on our outreach efforts. So we have, like I mentioned, we have the newsletter that provides updates about our activities. We have a LinkedIn group and Twitter. And last year we published a report in our complimentary journal, the database journal, on the 2021 virtual conference. And we also plan to publish another similar report on this conference this year. And then, yes, like I mentioned, the e-learning course with 4 modules. This is something that we're working on to be hopefully to be launched in the next year. There'll be these online e-learning, so online webinars or kind of self-paced training materials that will cover topics including introduction to biocuration, manually curated resources and use cases. There'll be topics covering ontologies and also topics covering careers in biocuration in either academia or industry. So additional work, so I've already mentioned outreach and training and IT infrastructure. Outreach and training was led by Federica and other members, included Sushma, Randy, Marianne, and Robin. Ruth led our IT kind of website, kind of all that work, and with Rama and Federica and Robin. Parul was in charge of the award committee, and she helped us with revising the way that we were voting on the awards in the last year. So we now are allowing the membership to vote versus a dedicated committee. Anyone has any feedback about that process, we'd love to hear that. It's to be determined if we will continue this next year or if we'll go back to the old mechanisms. We will be talking about that amongst the executive committee in the next year. And if anyone has any feedback, we'd love to hear that. And Randy has been in charge of the fellowships and grants that we are offering through the EC. There are other opportunities for the community to participate in addition to running for election onto the executive committee, which is about to be determined for this year, but next year there's that opportunity. We also have the Equity, Diversity, and Inclusion Subcommittee, and anybody from the community is welcome to join. You don't even have to be a member of the ISB to participate in this or a member of the executive committee. So these are the members who participated formally in the last year. There's monthly meetings that are held virtually and everybody is welcome to join. Some highlights from the last year included a workshop that was held at the UK local Biocuration conference in May. And that was really well received and had really good attendance. The EDI committee is also developing policies to collect optional demographic information from our members and conference activities. And this helps us allow us to determine the kind of demographic representation in our group and also help with recruitment of identify underrepresented groups, and then we can improve our recruitment and outreach to these groups. And we're also trying to ensure that our policies are easily accessible. The EDI helped come up with the code of conduct that's available on our website, and we're also developing some formal disciplinary procedures that if anyone violates the code of conduct, we'll have some documented formal disciplinary actions that will follow through if that hopefully doesn't ever arise. And we've also invited, the EDI committee also invited an external human resources expert to advise on the policy. So we'll get some external feedback about our policies that we're developing through the EDI. In addition to the EDI committee, we also recruit volunteers throughout the year for various roles, such as the election subcommittee. So this year, Sabrina Toro led the effort to organize the nominees for the election and help oversee the election process to make sure this is really important for us to have an external committee that oversees the elections to make sure that we're not just doing this internally. We have an external resource overseeing what we're doing. And so we recruit members from the community to form the election subcommittee and oversee the nomination process and the elections to make sure it's done fairly and without any bias. So we thank our external members, Sabrina, Christina, Kayo, Pataba, and Pankaj for participating in this past year. And next year we'll be recruiting new people. So if you're interested in participating in that, please let us know, or we'll be reaching out to people individually and making a formal call sometime probably next summer. And then the conferences are really big lifts and are a really important part of the work that our society does. So this year we've done the virtual conference as we did last year and the year before at the last minute. Next year we're going to be hosting the conference in Italy, and thanks to Federica, who will be the local organizer, and Charlie will be co-chairing with her. For this year, the conference is our final session, and for next year, the conference committee is already formed, but in the future, we will need new members for the conference committee. So this is another community opportunity that everyone has the opportunity to option to participate if they're interested in that. And speaking of the conferences and workshops, just a bit of an overview of what we've done this year. So Ruth and Levering and Rachel Huntley and Yasmin participated in organizing a local conference that was held in the UK in May, and this was very successful. And many thanks to all of those who were participating in the organizing committee and those who attended. I think there's about 100 people in attendance, and sounded like it was a very successful in-conference, which was held just regionally due to COVID restrictions. And then as you know, we're currently underway with the 2022 virtual conference series, and this is the last session of the series. And really a huge thanks to all the organizers, Federica, Charlie, Nicholas, Lushma, Raman, and Philip for your efforts in helping coordinate and organize this conference. One of the highlights we had from the virtual conference this year too was our Biocuration Careers Workshop that I helped organize along with several of our other EC members, Randy and Mary Ann, and then a couple of external people, Christy Holmes and Muhammad Hosseini, where we had a workshop to talk about ways that the ISB can assist biocreators in the community with their career progression. The whole idea for this session came up from a discussion from the panel at the last year's virtual conference, where there seemed to be questions about how do we best support career progression in the field of biocreation. So we talked a lot about different. We talked about how there's a lot of different job titles and should these be standardized, and ways we can get better credit and attribution for our work. We've sent out a survey with this link here at the bottom to try to get an idea of what people would like to talk about next. And we're going to plan to organize another follow-up careers workshop at the conference next year in Italy. So speaking of Italy, the conference will be next year in Italy. We have already established our organizing committee. This is led by Federica and Charlie, and Ruth is also co-chairing this conference. And we have the organizing committee who's already working on getting the conference organized, and the scientific program committee is already set. I didn't put the dates on here, so it'll be in late April of 2023, and we really hope that everyone will be able to come join us in Italy. Hopefully there'll be no further issues with COVID, and more details will be sent out very soon after we wrap up this conference. And there's a link, Charlie posted a link to the conference webpage in the chat. And then we were supposed to have a conference in New Delhi, India in 2021, and we've been pushing it back due to COVID. But this is the plan for the 2024 conference, is to host the conference in Italy. Thanks to Sarab for generously offering to host the conference here. This would be a very amazing experience, and hopefully we'll all be able to attend. So we only have about 3 minutes left, but we have time for a few questions. And one question I really want to ask just the community and everyone on this call is, what do you hope to see the ISB executive committee accomplish in the next year? So we will be meeting on a monthly basis with our new members starting in November. And we really welcome you to provide feedback either in the chat here on Zoom. You can send us messages via Slack, via email, Twitter. All the mechanisms of communication are wide open. And I really love to hear
people's thoughts in the chat. Then we can sort of bring them up. I can read things out loud if people don't want to turn on their microphone.
Yeah, perfect. And if anyone wants to speak up right now, we still have 2 minutes before the next speaker.
I've got something to kick it off. At the end of last year's AGM, we were talking about there was this hole burning in the pocket of the ISB budget, and you wanted to come up with some new funding schemes. And we've got these micro grants and some kind of travel awards, and associated with like this money, people have to write a blog post about what they did. I think that's been pretty cool. I'm still interested to kind of reopen that discussion. Are there other things that ISB could kind of fund, like small curation efforts, small projects? if people had ideas about that, about creating little funding schemes, or if ISB could facilitate, you know, people who want some money to do something like very tiny but interesting.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think that would be great. I had an idea at one point to create like some open educational resources. I think that's kind of what's going to turn the effort that Federica is now leading with the training efforts. So it's kind of turned into that. But I had an idea to fund people to develop training materials, kind of give them some money to help pay for their time and such. But yeah, I'd love to see that happen. I think we could probably do it through the form of microgrants. But if you had another idea of a different mechanism to do that, we would love to consider that. Anyone else have any thoughts? Anyone else from the EC want to chime in, or anyone else from the community?
This is Ruth. I was just going to say, we did discuss whether to fund supporting resources that needed long-term funding, and decided that that wasn't appropriate because during the EC, it was decided that that wasn't appropriate. So I just thought I'd just mention that as a inappropriate source that was agreed.
That might have partly been one of my ideas that got shut down.
But at least you asked.
Yeah.
Sorry, Sushma, go ahead.
Okay. We had also another idea that sometimes some of the papers publication cost could be covered, and we could announce like the best paper type of thing. Three papers and support the publication cost of that. A small workshop, biocuration workshop, along with any major conference, including ISB, some funding for that. So these are like the open suggestions at this point. Yeah, that's it.
I was just gonna say, in the interest of keeping us on time, we should move on to the award speakers. But do you want to quickly comment, Robin? I don't want to.
No, it's okay. Continue. I can always follow up later. It's fine.
Okay. Thanks.
Okay. So thank you so much for your talk, Nicole, and thank you for updating on the work of the society during this year and what we are going to do next year. And indeed, as Nicole said, we are going to have our first in-person conference after the pandemic in Padova, Italy, next year. And now we're going to move to the Biocuration Awards talks. The first speaker is Shirin Saverimuttu, who won the Early Career Biocuration Award for 2022. So Shirin, please, you can share your slides.
Can I just make a quick note? We're actually not going to do a question session at the end of this. So what would be great is if people have questions, go ahead and put them in the chat on Zoom. And then I think people have really interesting discussions on these virtual conferences when you just start chatting at the same time. And then the speaker can check that out after they're done and try and respond where they can. And anything that doesn't get resolved, maybe we can spill over into Slack, or people can trade contact information and have some follow-up sort of in private. So yeah, thanks for being involved in this discussion, or just listen. Yeah, go ahead, Shirin. Thank you.
Thanks. Can I just check that everyone can see the right screen?
Yeah, we can.
Okay. Hi, my name is Shirin, and as mentioned, I'm this year's recipient for the Early Career Award. In my presentation today, I'll be introducing myself and talking about some of the work I've been a part of over the past few years. Yep, so a little about me. In terms of education, I have a bachelor's degree in human biosciences from Coventry University and a master's in the genetics of human disease from UCL. And it was during my MSc that I was first introduced to biocuration, and it led me to my first job as a genontology biocurator at UCL2. In 2020, after a year at UCL, I then moved on to Emble EBI to work as an intern scientific curator for the PGS catalog, and later as a full-time scientific curator for this catalog, as well as the GWAS catalog too. And then in 2021, I moved just across campus at the EBI to work at SciBi as a scientific curator there in the ontologies team. As I've moved around a bit in the past few years, I would like to take this time to present brief overviews of the curation work I've done at UCL, Emble EBI, and also at SciBi. So to begin with, I'd like to talk about the initial biocuration work I did as an MSc student at UCL, as it's what got me into curation in the first place. In my first project, it focused on the gene ontology curation of microRNAs, and this was to improve the analysis of Alzheimer's disease data sets. So for a bit of background, amyloid beta accumulation has been hypothesized to be a primary cause of Alzheimer's disease with a dysregulation to proteins like amyloid beta clearance receptors, thought to be kind of critical in the process. And microRNAs have also been found to be altered in brain tissue affected by Alzheimer's disease, and also like several hundred have been experimentally proven to regulate the expression of amyloid beta clearance receptors. So in terms of how microRNAs can regulate these receptors, I think this might be a good kind of diagram here to explain it. So essentially the microRNA has like a near perfect complementary sequence to part of the mRNA transcript. And in this case, it would be the amyloid beta clearance receptor transcript. And this complementary sequence allows the microRNA to bind directly to the transcript, targeting it for cleavage, deadenylation, or translational repression. So in order to capture how microRNAs silence the gene expression of amyloid beta clearance receptors, literature searches first had to be conducted to find relevant publications, and full article curation was then completed when we found suitable papers. There were several assays that could be used to experimentally prove a microRNA was able to bind and or target a mRNA transcript, resulting in a reduction in translation. They included like luciferase assays, Western blots, and qRT-PCRs. And on this slide here, I've included an example of experimental evidence and an annotation that could be made. So here you can see there's a luciferase assay showing the addition of MER181B and how it was able to significantly reduce the expression of TLR4. And this led to the following annotation being created. So here you can see we have the RNA central ID for the MER, and we can see that it's also got a go term to describe the function, which is miRNA mediated gene silencing. And you can see that it's then at the end here, we have the UniProt ID to show that its effect is on TLR4. So what did this project lead to? In short, it resulted in around 40 microRNAs being identified as able to target and reduce the expression of 18 amyloid beta clearance receptor transcripts. And for those who don't know, this is a cytoscape diagram showing these interactions where the nodes or the circles represent the mRNAs and the MERS, whilst the edges, which are the lines, represent the interactions between these entities. So this was kind of some of the work that I did as a genealogy biocurator at UCL, and it kind of spilled over into the job that I then took up with the functional gene annotation team, where I also did a bit of teaching as well. So I'll now move on to talk about my time as a scientific curator at the PGS catalogue. In order to explain the work I did there, I thought it might be useful to include a slide on what polygenic risk scores are for those who may not necessarily know. So we have complex diseases that occur as a result of many genomic variants paired with environmental influences. And these diseases can also be known as polygenic diseases. And an example is coronary artery disease. So essentially, a polygenic score will combine several variants associated with a polygenic disease, and it can then be used to predict an individual's relative risk for a disease. And in terms of how the scores are developed, it's usually using a source sample, and in most cases it will be from a genome-wide association study, which you can see here, and its summary statistics. These are used to identify the SNPs and their effect weights. You can then have additional training samples like here, and these can be used to help optimize the score a little better. There'll then be an independent validation sample, and that will be used to test the performance of a polygenic score. So the next question was, why is there a need for a PGS catalog? As I thought this might be useful information. And it lies in the fact there are multiple polygenic scores, can be developed for a single complex trait. These scores can be developed in different ways using different methods, sample sizes, and ancestries. And this makes comparing the performance of a of polygenic spores for a trait a little bit difficult. So here you can see in this kind of diagram, we have three different polygenic spores for breast cancer. They've been developed using different methods. They've the source and training samples differ in terms of size as well as ancestry, and so do the validation samples. And you can also see that the performance metrics as well here differ using kind of different types of metrics. So this kind of leads researchers to ask the following questions, such as like what polygenic scores have been developed for my trait of interest, which polygenic scores can be applied to my cohort, should I develop a new PGS, or which polygenic score performs best. And subsequently, this kind of leads to the inhibition of PGS research progression and translation into healthcare. So what did we do at the polygenic score catalogue? So we kind of found a load of suitable publications, and we kind of collated the information and placed it onto the PGS catalogue. So it allowed people in the field to come and view the information with relative ease and also be able to reuse the polygenic scores as well. So just in this slide here, I show that we first find publications using different kind of sources such as EuroPMC, Google Alerts, Twitter, PubMed, and so on. And then from these papers, once we check that they kind of fulfill our criteria at the PGS catalog, we curate the polygenic score, and this will include any RSIDs or their chromosomal locations, effect alleles, effect allele weights. As well as this, we pull and curate relevant metadata, such as information on the score. So this would be like the predicted traits, the score development methods, and the number of variants. We also kind of pull information about the different samples used to identify, develop, and independently validate the score. So this would be like case control numbers, male to female ratio, and ancestry information, as well as a few more bits and bobs. We also curate the performance metrics. These could be effect sizes, classification accuracy, other metrics, as well as any covariates that are included. And finally, we pull the publication information, such as the DOI, the first author name, and the date of the publication. So kind of how this information gets stored and used. So the polygenic score itself kind of goes into a text file, which you can see here in the middle screenshot, whilst the other information, which we called like the relevant metadata for the score, is curated and put into an Excel spreadsheet, and this is uploaded onto the PGS catalog. And if you'd like to view how this is kind of displayed on the PGS catalog, you can also view their website as well. So that kind of concludes my time at the PGS catalog. It was mostly me training for 6 months, and then I moved into the scientific curator role, and then left shortly to join SciBite. So this is where I'm based now, and at SciBite we primarily work with life science organizations like pharmaceutical companies, and we help them to enable fair use of their data. I'm sure a lot of people here might know about their data, and probably a lot more so than me. But just as a quick overview, by FAIR, we mean trying to make the data easily findable and once found accessible. The data also needs to be interoperable, so it should be easy to exchange between individuals and interpret. And the same applies there shouldn't need to be any kind of specialized software or algorithms being needed to kind of read the data. And finally, the ultimate goal is for the data to be reusable by others. But when companies are trying to implement their data principles within their organizations, there can be limitations that they face. Some of them are mentioned here. So for example, their data may be legacy data existing in unstructured formats such as PDFs and electronic lab notebooks. This data will likely be inconsistently tagged, and many terms will have multiple names or identifiers. Another limitation is that these organizations may have disconnected data silos that have been added by acquisitions or mergers, and these are frequently not accessible to parts of the organization. And they also may have competing ontologies and vocabularies. And this can lead to a number of problems, such as multiple names or identifiers for the same entity, little to no version control, difficulties in identifying owners and suggesting edits, as just some of the examples. These limitations subsequently make it hard for the data to be searched for or found, then accessed and used for kind of new discoveries. So where does SciBite come in? Well, we can help with some of the limitations that companies face when trying to implement their data principles. And in the presentation today, I'll speak about how we use curation to help with the limitation of unstructured legacy data. At SciBite, we have a software called Termite, which is our named entity recognition and extraction engine software, which is API first. It can be used alongside something called our hand curated SciBite vocabularies to help structure data. So if we start here on the left-hand side, we can have a variety of ontologies from SciBite. We have the public ontologies and we also have customer ontologies. And using our curation expertise, we can optimize these ontologies for our customers as well as Termite, and we turn them into our SciBite vocabularies that you can see here. The unstructured legacy data can then be uploaded to Termite and run over the vocab files, tagging the unstructured data to IDs and their terms from the vocab files that we have. And what this kind of creates is this rich machine-readable data, which can be utilized by the company. In terms of how this now structured data can be utilized, prior to being tagged with SciBite vocabulary terms, it would have been hard to find using search kind of software, especially if various synonyms for a term have been used throughout a document. So by running through Termite and tagging the data, this document can be easily findable. And an example is through our SciBite search, which is an engine used to find documentation that our customers can have. So for my last slide, I will just go into a little bit of detail on the type of curation that we do. So our curation mainly works to reduce ambiguity of terms and their synonyms, but also to expand on or reduce the number of synonyms for entities. Like I said before, this helps us to optimize the vocabs for both Termite and our customers' needs. On this slide, you can see that as curators over here, we can apply global rules to our vocab files. So in this example, we can apply a global rule, which is to always pluralize synonyms. Once this is applied, it will be applied to all terms within the vocab file. And in this example, you have the term cookie and its synonym biscuit, but the global rule will mean that when running through Termite, words such as cookies and biscuits in the unstructured data will also be tagged with the food ID for cookie automatically. Next up, we can also apply local switches, and these are done to individual terms. In this example on the screen, we have the term cyclic AMP and its synonym camp. Of course, camp can refer to more than just cyclic AMP, so to ensure it's context specific, we apply to a switch to say match this particular case form only. So only match to lowercase c and uppercase AMP rather than all lowercase CAMP or all uppercase CAMP. And last but not least, we can add or remove synonyms. Often enough, there will be multiple ways to describe an entity. Looking back again at cookie, you can see it can also be called a biscuit. So we look to add in as many synonyms as possible to terms so that unstructured data can be well tagged with our vocabs. And this will also ensure that entities are not being missed out or left untagged. And last but not least, we also remove synonyms. And this usually happens when we find them to create too much noise, where they can be like too generic and quite hard to contextualize. So that kind of ends my presentation today on some of the work that I've been doing. I would like to say thank you to a lot of people. This includes my old professor from UCL, Ruth Lovering, who got me into curation in the first place and has been a really great mentor over the past few years, as well as Barbara, who's no longer at UCL because she's moved on, but she was also a really great help during my time there. It includes my many managers and supervisors at Emble EBI, including Jackie, Eva, Sam, and Laura. And finally, it also includes Jane and Rachel from SciBite and the rest of the ontologies team, who puts up with my many endless questions at the moment. And finally, I'd like to thank the ISB community too for recognizing me for this award. Thank you for listening. That was it, sorry.
Great, thank you. So like I mentioned, if anyone wants to ask some questions, you can try and use the chat, and Shirin's probably going to hang around and maybe she can answer some of your questions. There's already a little bit of discussion you might want to chime in on. And so, yeah, without further ado, I'd like to introduce Antonia Locke, who's from the EBI in Hingston, and she has received the Excellence in Biocuration Advanced Career Award. She's going to give a short talk on that. So Antonia, please go ahead. Thank you for being here. We can't hear you, though. You're on mute.
Sorry. Can you hear me now?
All good.
Go okay. ahead. And I've lost my... Oh, there we go. Okay. So, hi. I'm Antonia. And I would firstly like to say thank you to the whole of the ISB for the award. I feel very honored. So a bit about me. I finished my PhD around 2011, and I was very excited to be offered a role at Pombase, as I wanted to stay in science, but not at the lab bench. And then in 2016, I moved to Helix, which is a startup, or it was a startup, focusing on repurposing drugs to benefit patients with rare diseases. And access to pre-curated datasets was very fundamental to what we did, and it made me realize just how valuable curated resources are, not just to academic resources, researchers, but also to industry. And then in 2020, I moved to UniProt with its rather massive scope, which is all the proteins in the world. I stay challenged in choosing worthwhile papers to curate. So in all my roles, I've had to pinpoint papers worthwhile of curation, and I've taken different approaches to finding particularly valuable papers. So I'm sure that everyone here has heard of the gene ontology, which is used to make functional statements about genes and proteins. And historically, these GO annotations were made in quite a standalone manner. So proteins were annotated to functions and processes, but there was no way to connect these annotations together or to connect genes to each other. So in this example, check one is annotated as having protein serine threonine kinase activity, and it participates in a number of different processes, but there are no connections to other genes or between different annotations. And we wanted to start connecting annotations and genes together, and so we started curating targets of enzymatic functions. So for example, here check one is annotated as being a protein kinase, but also that it phosphorylates several different targets. And together with other annotation groups, we created a system in which to extend GO annotations so that we could capture connections between genes, functions, and pathways. So we could say that check one phosphorylates RLC1 as part of regulation of ectomycin contractile ring contraction, for instance. And fast forward a decade, and this concept is now, of course, also enabled by curating GoCal models in Noctua. And essentially what we were doing was to link proteins and RNAs together into these directional interaction networks. So here I'm showing all the connections made between genes annotated to the Go term signaling. And what we can see that although most genes are highly connected and linked to other genes, there are some proteins that are not linked to any other proteins or only linked to a few other proteins. And one way to increase the value of curation is to target these largely unconnected genes for annotation to see if we can link them up into this network. So we are essentially looking for curation gaps in our data sets. And it's a directed approach to look for high value papers containing robust functional data. And then when I moved to UniProt, the scope of what I could curate obviously broadened a lot, and I now had the possibility to curate any of the 227 million proteins residing in UniProt. And with over 34 million papers in PubMed, there's certainly enough papers to curate. And not only are there more and more papers published and genome sequenced, but the burden of curation has also increased over the years. So for newer low throughput papers, so not including high throughput papers, will on average contain 4 to 10 times more data compared to older papers containing gene-specific data. And at UniProt, I find that I shifted my focus from curating curation gaps to targeting newly published papers characterizing these gaps in our knowledge. And partly I focus on fungal proteins involved in pathogenic processes. So fungi cause more than 1.5 million deaths per year worldwide, and there are very few antifungal drugs approved for humans. And additionally, they also destroy a third of all crops annually, so they are very important in terms of food security. And the other area I focus on is continuing to utilize yeast as models of biology, and I actively look for publications where I may be able to use knowledge gained in yeast to plug knowledge gaps in other organisms. And even though organisms may be separated by large evolutionary distances, at the cellular level, processes typically remain remarkably similar. So over 70% of genes in yeast have human orthologs. And if we look at the broad functional classification of fish and yeast genes, or proteins, and we map them onto their taxonomic conservation, we see that proteins involved in some processes, such as translation or transmembrane transport, are ancestrally conserved. So that's the tan parts of the pies here. So they are conserved all the way to from eukaryotes to archaea and prokaryotes. Whereas other processes, such as mitotic cell cycle or signaling, are broadly conserved among eukaryotes, but perhaps not so commonly conserved to prokaryotes and archaea. And we can use this information to help make decisions about what the information to propagate. So for example, these ancestral proteins are more likely to be conserved at a very granular level. So for example, glycolysis proteins, whereas these less broadly conserved proteins appear more divergent, then we may only be able to transfer perhaps more high level annotations like signaling, but we can't propagate more granular processes like specific signaling pathways. And this was a nice example I came across in literature a while ago. So, In 2014, the yeast TLS1 protein was characterized as a splicing protein. And the authors predicted that the human orthologue C9ORF78 would perform a similar function. And now, 8 years later, this Nature Communication paper came out that confirmed that it's indeed involved in splicing. And as part of our project looking at unknown proteins, so these are the proteins where we have no idea what processes or pathways they function in, we found that just under 20% of the yeast proteomes are completely uncharacterized in terms of the pathways. And remarkably, this number remained very similar in human, despite humans having 3 times the size of the yeast proteomes. And if you look at the taxonomic breakdown of these unknown proteins, many of them are conserved to eukaryotes, and a small portion of them are also conserved to archaea and bacteria. So how do I find papers describing novel protein characterizations? So personally, I use this tool called PubCrawler. And I've set up searches to look for novel, new, uncharacterized proteins in fungi and yeast and so on. And every week I get an email containing a list of publications that matches my search. And I look through this list and add papers that look interesting to my ever-growing to-do list. And obviously, when I get around to actually curating a paper, I must then check that the proteins described in the paper can be mapped to proteins that are contained within UniProt. And finding interesting papers really takes time, but this is not something that's reflected in metrics typically. And I think it would be great if publishers could aid us a little bit in identifying valuable papers. For example, they could make author-specified gene identifiers so that we are alerted if unknown proteins are characterized, or just help us with mappings. And additionally, I think that starting out with very recent literature is good practice in general, as it helps to weed out papers that have been superseded by a more modern understanding of biology. So at Pombis, we set up this community curation effort to make use of author expertise. So here, newly published fishing yeast papers are pooled into the curation tool Canto. We then send out invitations to authors and reminders if needed. And the authors will then send us curation for the papers, and we might feedback to the authors on their annotations. And once everyone is happy, the annotations, well, this whole process results in a set of database ready annotations that can be loaded into the database. And what we found, we came up with a set of nudges to help incentivize submissions. So for example, we would highlight that curated publications become more visible in the database, and also that the whole process satisfies funders' dissemination requirements. We realized that authors were more likely to respond when the publications were still new. So invitations are sent out in a timely manner, and we tried to make the tool very easy to use so it avoids jargon. And we also try to implement a social element. So we advertise community curated publications, we visibly attribute community curators, and we also send personalized invites. And in general, participants view the process very positively. So most people agree that their papers become more visible, and the process also furthers their own understanding of curated data. So I was also tasked at specifying metadata that should be associated with genome-wide datasets. And the system would have to handle very varied data types, from gene expression to transposon insertion sites or replication origins. And I looked around to see what existing metadata standards existed and how other databases classified the data. But I couldn't really find any specifications or system to how to describe all these very diverse data sets. But I think I arrived at a system that enables very consistent labeling of data sets to promote data reuse. And sometimes we need to revisit old annotations. So sometimes because the underlying understanding of biology has changed, and sometimes because mistakes have been made. So at the EBI Uniprot team, I act as the Goa curator, which essentially means that I'm tasked with maintaining all the legacy annotations, which is not a small task. So across all of Uniprot, so that's both the SIB and the EBI, over 450,000 manual Goa annotations have been created. And of these, over 214,000 are based on experimental findings from the literature, and they result in 600 million automatic annotations. So I liaise with the Go Consortium for annotation updates as their ontology is revised, and I also update erroneous annotations as they are flagged by other groups or users. And annotation revision is really important. So in this example, someone queried why this family of proteins are annotated to these Go terms, but it turns out, and it's because these six manually reviewed proteins were associated with the wrong EC number. And then that led to the propagation of these annotations to all of the unreviewed entries. So just by fixing this little thing here, we corrected thousands of Go annotations, because small errors and fixing small errors can have very large effects. And I was also part of a wider effort to identify annotation errors in Go annotation across different organisms, which became known as the Matrix Project. So we looked at annotation intersects among proteins, and any protein may be annotated to multiple Go terms, as I showed with the CHK1 example. But at the very high level, Go term level, there's very little overlap. So for example, proteins that are involved in cell division are typically not involved in transmembrane transport, for example. And we can use this knowledge to create rules so that proteins that are involved in Go term X are not involved in process Y. And then when any annotations are made to violate the rules, we can review them. And at the end of this project, we corrected a few hundred manual annotations, which led to over 53,000 automatically propagation, the correction of them. So again, small fixes can have very large effects. So finally, I'd just like to finish with some thoughts on how we can improve the biocreation ecosystem. So I think we should actively choose papers to plug these curation gaps in order to improve the breadth and depth of annotation. And I wish that publishers could help us more. So demand that authors provide identifiers for proteins and perhaps even provide keywords that describe the different data types that are covered in the paper. I also really wish that they would stop authors from supplying data tables in image format, because this becomes very annoying when you're having to type in a lot of IDs. I also think it would be useful if there was a repository that enabled centralized tracking of curation activities. For instance, mark up literature for data types or flag what resources that annotate the different papers for what data types. And maybe so that curators could leave comments to other curators to say why something wasn't annotated to prevent errors from creeping back in. And I also think that we should encourage annotation corrections more, as from what I've showed, very small fixes can have very large effects. And unfortunately, as we know, metrics typically don't encourage annotation fixes. And lastly, I think I would just like to say that what we do is very important and good and valuable work. Sometimes when I describe what I do, I think it's difficult to sell biocuration as the dynamic and exciting field that it is. So I think the independent reviews that the EBI commissioned, I think that they really show what the impact that us curators have. So they show that the value of investment is about 20 times the original investment. And a lot of people always say that curation is a very expensive process, but I would really like to challenge this because according to the numbers that were published as part of this publication, using the NIH as an example, they only spend about 0.37% of their research budget on curation activities, excluding the NLM resources. And that really doesn't seem like very much to me. And users really appreciate what we do. So I would like to thank all my colleagues, past and present, especially Val for mentoring me, all of the Go Consortium for interesting discussions, Jane and Richard at Helix, and at Uniprot, I would especially like to thank Rosanna and Michelle and Yvonne for helping me a lot with specific Uniprot curation. But also for interesting discussions, because sometimes it feels like every case is an edge case when doing literature curation. So thank you.
There were a couple questions in the chat. I can try and read them off to you, or maybe you want to go and look back and see what people are.
I can go and look back. I've lost my other screens. That's why I had a problem earlier. Oh no, I think I found it. Yes.
Well, anyway, we're just a little bit behind on schedule, but I think we can still do some questions. So let's see. One of them was any routes to the greater number. Actually, maybe you want to go ahead, Christopher, and just ask the question yourself. Oh, okay.
Sorry, but,
right. Sorry, let's try again, shall I? Yeah. Very nice talk, Antonia. I'll leave my questions in the chat and ask an extra one. This is the famous old chestnut. So we all know papers can be good, bad, and ugly. Mm. So how do you assess the quality of which papers you want to leave out? And I think we'd agree. The quality of PubMed is dropping slowly but surely as the major publishers, they're piling them high. We got a long tail of, you know all about it. So what do you do for your informal, explicit or implicit quality filtration of what you decide to pick up?
I think that sometimes, I mean, you can look at the journal and that will give you an indication. You can also look at the types of evidence that's presented in the paper. So if the more functional data the paper describes, like deep, robust, so say they characterize targets of genes rather than just phenotypes, I think that will give you a better idea if you can trust the data or not. Because obviously with, for example, just phenotypic data, you can see a lot of indirect effects perhaps. So I do think the type of evidence that's playing.
Good. Just one brief one. In terms of the Go tracker for the pseudo enzyme active sites, I don't see an extra tag for saying, yes, this is a protease, but we think it's dead. Is there any way to tag that? I can't, it's not there now in Go. Does anyone else know?
So where are you, where do you mean, where are you looking?
For example, you see a whole lot of enzymes and kinases and proteases. Go marks their active sites up, but you know the active sites are dead. Yeah, so it's a question of discriminating those. They're sometimes marked as, or they're reported as pseudoenzymes, but Go will still stamp that as an active site.
Oh, right, yeah. So Go does allow us to create not annotations. So we can say that even though, which you would typically use in cases where you might think that something has a function, but it doesn't actually have that function.
All right. Well, okay, fine. That's fine.
So it sounds like those dead kinases should get that not annotation to kinase activity.
All right. Okay. Thanks.
Great. So there are a couple more questions, but I'm going to cut it off right there, and I'm going to jump us back into the plan for today. And so, yeah, let me just end the first part of this session with sort of a valediction. So we already mentioned that ISB 2023 will be returning in person in Italy next year. And basically the rest of this session for today is basically going to be on this thing called gather.town. And maybe you're familiar with this, maybe not. It's a website that allows us to kind of walk around in a virtual space and continue some of these interesting conversations. There's also going to be a small poster session. So you'll get the chance to walk around and see some posters as well. The link to that is right here. I'm going to add this to the Zoom chat. I'm going to hang around for a couple minutes. And so people can kind of filter in there between now and maybe 5-10 minutes. We're going to call this like a coffee break. But I think whenever you're ready, if you're interested, you can kind of filter into this gather.town space. And then we can continue some of the nice discussions. So yeah, this is kind of what it looks like. I was walking around earlier. I've got my own little avatar. And so yeah, let me go ahead and copy paste this information to the Zoom chat. Feel free to join if you want to leave us now. Thank you so much for listening. Thank you for making this 2022 session of our virtual Biocuration conference just as fun as the last one. We know everyone's getting a little tired of Zoom, and yeah, we're really excited to see you in person next year. But keep up with us. There's lots of resources that are available through ISB. We're going to make sure that those keep getting posted via our Twitter account, via their website, biocuration.org. And then like you can always just get in touch, like all the normal ways if you want to find out more. So I'm going to stop screen sharing. I'm going to go ahead and paste those links for you. And again, one more big thank you to everybody. Thanks to the speakers. Excellent talks. Thank you, Nicole, for giving the AGM. Thank you, Federica, for all the really hard work, like actually running the show in the background. And thanks everyone for attending. So I hope to see you on Gather Town. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye.